Вот. Пошло. Вот она, пошло видео, видишь, 17. Пошло.
Там, ну, просто сядешь, чтобы тут не было.
Ask questions as we break down film. I like to get you guys involved. I think that's a better way to help you all learn and rather than just monologue for me. So, oh, I have to put my time wrong because I didn't give me one quick second to find out what time I need to be out there for the next game so I know when to break this off. Today is Sunday. Okay, 9:15 is my first game. So we'll break this off at about 9:05-ish. Alright? So what we'll do is, I'll ask again. First question is, let's see, starting with you, Michael, and we'll just go this way. How long have you been refereeing? How many years? At what's your highest level? And how many games do you think you were, just an approximation of how many games you would say you worked this past season?
Okay, since I live in the US, that was the season 2010-2011. Mm-hmm. Prior to that, 15 years over in Germany.
15 years in Germany?
Yes, up to, you can say, a low, mid, D1 level.
Okay. And how many games would you say in the last full season you worked?
40.
Okay.
This is my fifth year.
Fifth year?
Completed my first year doing junior college.
Okay.
And I did probably 40 high school games, like 15 junior college games.
So about 55 games. All right, Eric?
Ninth year, worked Division III women's, JUCO and high school, combined 70 games last year.
Fedor?
I called maybe 73rd season, and I called in the Russian league,
right?
Close to 85 games in the high league, men and women. From 97, I'm national referee.
Right. Okay. And how many years again? 30?
32.
Good for you. Okay. All right, so a lot of games for most of you, based on my notes here, from 40 to 85, it's lots of games that we're working, and obviously varying levels of experience, right? So here's the next question, and just don't try to overthink it, but be honest with the answer. Out of all the games you would say you worked last year, how many of those games did you get the tape and break it down of that game?
Not enough.
Give me a number. Give me a range. Did you say you did about 40?
I have, I didn't do a high school game breakdown.
Sure, so out of all the games you did, what was...
For college, I would say 70% of my games.
70%? Out of the 55 or so you did, 40 and 15 JUCO?
I did 15.
15 out of 55?
Eight
out of, again, what was your number?
70.
8 out of 70, 85?
Yeah, I look about how many games I look?
Yes.
Yeah, all games
all,
in the top division.
In the top division, so about 85 out of 85.
Yeah, yeah.
Okay, so the reason why I ask that is because in order to get better at this craft, and in order to go where you're trying to go in officiating, we all have different goals, we all have different aspirations. The single most invaluable tool that you will need to get better is this. If you're not doing this, you're doing yourself a great disservice. It's like if you are trying to lose weight and you go to the gym and you work out for an hour, then the rest of the day you eat Burger King, McDonald's, Chick-fil-A, Long John Silver's, and all this kind of crap. You totally defeat the purpose of that hour you just put in the gym, right? You may see some results, but you're not gonna see the results you want. And then you're gonna start questioning, why am I not losing the weight that I thought I should be losing? Just like officials will say, why am I not in the D2 league? Why am I not getting better gains? Why am I not getting more gains? It's because you're not doing this. And if you're not doing this, I would highly recommend we start doing this consistently in the 80 to 90% pile of our games, okay? It's the only way you will get better. It is the only way you can know what you need to work on, right? Because if you don't see yourself on tape, you have no idea what you're screwing up ever. You don't know. You can speculate. But if you don't watch the tape, you don't know. I tell people, just like I told all the groups I did the other day, working a game is like taking a test in high school, college, whatever. I give you a test, you all take the test. Now, most people, when they take the test, they want to know what? After they take the test. What do you want to know? You want to know how you did, right? You don't want to just know. You just don't want to take the test and never say, okay, 5 weeks later, you're like, remember that test, Mr. Williams, that you gave us? Will we ever figure out what we got? No, don't worry about it. Well, how do you know what you don't know? You'll never know, right? You took the test, but you don't know how well you did. This is taking the test when you're working. You're taking a test. The breaking down the film is the results. That's your score. And hopefully as you do this and you build and you build, you start at probably, let's say, 75% of getting your place right, 70-75, if we're honest. And you want to work your way up to the 90 percentile. And the only way you can make that jump is by doing this. Okay, so I highly recommend that. When we watch tape, we talk about pressing the pause button, killing the pause button. Because we always want to look at, when we blow the whistle, we want to look at what? What are the three things we'll look at when we blow the whistle on tape?
Positioning, coverage.
So, yeah, that all falls in it. So the first thing we want to look at is it my primary? When I look at tape and I pause it, my first question is this my primary? My second question when I ask myself when I blow the whistle, when we're talking about just looking at plays, we'll look at other things, mechanics and positioning, things like that. But when we're talking about breaking down plays, the second thing I want to ask is, do I have an open look on this play that I just blew the whistle on? And then after that, I'm going to ask myself, what's my whistle cadence? Do I have a primary cadence whistle? Do I have a secondary cadence whistle? Those are the three things I want to ask myself every time I blow the whistle when I'm looking at play calling. And in addition to play calling, we're looking at, do I look athletic? Do I look like I belong on the floor? Are my eyes in the right spot? Am I refereeing the right defender? Things like that. How are my mechanics, or how are my signals, my presence? Do I use my voice? When I present to the table, does it look like it has some sharpness to it? Does it look like it's believable what I'm reporting to the table and essentially the gym? These are all the things you should be looking at when you're watching your film. And the more you do it, the better you get at it. And the better you get at this, the better you are at taking the test when you take the 94x50. All right, makes sense? So here we go. You'll be amazed. We're gonna watch probably 10 minutes of this, and it's gonna take the hour and 15 minutes because we're gonna do a lot of talking, right? Set my timer so I don't go overboard. Good. So let's start with here we go. And we're not gonna go off my notes a lot because we don't have clocks on this thing. We don't need clocks per se. We just talk about what we got. So we have a ball here, right? And this ball is basically located at the slot side lane line, right? Do we all know what we want? Slot side lane line, everybody's heard that term. So the ball's at slot side lane line, which means it's in the transition area between trail and the slot. This is the transition area where the trail in the slot, the ball is potentially going from one person's primary to the other. Does that make sense? If I say something that doesn't make sense or you're not sure, this is the time. Just say, hey, I don't have a word, I don't understand what you just said. And that is totally okay, all right? You don't want to be the person, the guy, the girl that doesn't understand and then you leave and you're, now you're wondering what it was about. That's why you paid your money, that's why you flew wherever you came from to do this so that we can help you, okay? So there is no, there's no wrong in you not knowing something. I said, I don't expect you to know everything that I'm getting ready to say. That's why we do this exercise. So if you don't understand something, please let me know and I'll be more than happy to further explain it. Trail should be right around 20 foot markish. Cat is in the slot. She's as free throw line extended as she should be. Lead's at you, Fedor. You're at the lead. So we've got transition area. Now, what we need to do in transition areas is we have to cue off of one another, trail and slot. We have to make eye contact, preferably the trail. It's always the trail's responsibility to check the eyes of the slot to see where he, or in this case, she is refereeing. Now, because this is going from this back into here, both guys, both officials are probably gonna be on it. We can see that her eyes are on the play, and I would guarantee you the trail is probably on it too. That's okay, this is where, this is that dual coverage area. Y'all understand what I mean by dual coverage? That's pretty self-explanatory, right? So it's a dual coverage area, which I would expect, you know, both of them to be on for a moment. Where I would be careful would be here. Why? Why would I be careful here with the way this play is developing? And it's open to anybody. The way this play is developing, dribble drive this way, why would I be careful here?
Well, you have this big guy over there. I mean, the drive for the paint, the help, it could be an outlet pass, and the other guy was out of bounds. So you have maybe something going on coming back in there.
We'll come up here and point out what you're saying, Mike.
Okay.
I'm not following.
He wants the drive here.
Yeah.
So primary defender, secondary may step up.
Right.
You
right.
have maybe here a matchup, but this guy comes back onto the court. So you can go for a pass. So there is potential of crash.
Okay. Well, there is potential for crash, but that's going five steps ahead of where we potentially are on this play right now.
Okay.
So the question right now is, if Kat is here in the slot, and she's in good position, and she's refereeing this defender, who's the primary defender, like you said, why would, if I'm in the slot, I'm always, wherever I am, I'm always preparing myself for what potentially may happen. Why would we want to be just, I'm saying to myself, I'm Cat, I'm going to be careful right here with blowing the whistle on this guy. Anyone know why?
Because the play's going away from
you. There you go. Boom. Because the play is starting to go away from you. It's going away from you and towards someone else. We want to be careful on plays that are going away from us. Our looks are never as good as we think they are. Right? You have to instinctively feel that on the floor. So the moment I see this guy driving this way, I'm like, oh, I'm going to pause. I'm going to really be patient with this guy. Especially with the strip down or something like that on this side, it's going to be hard for me to see it potentially. So what's closed to one referee is usually open to another, right? So anytime a play is going away from you, you really need to be very patient and cautious with your whistle because you're not going to have the best look, all right? So you're not going to have a look, but as it starts here, he would have a good look. As it starts and as it continues on, it becomes Fedor's best look, right? Okay. And that's exactly what happens, right? Now look what kind of angle you have, right?
Yeah.
Bad, right? Which is why you're doing what?
Position adjusting.
You're moving, you're trying to see, go somewhere to see. Now, I didn't even know this was going to happen. But just by watching film for a million years, that's how old I am, I knew as this started that I was going to already be in trouble. And you were in perfect position. That's okay. Problem we have as younger officials is we always think, oh, I got to go. And that's true, you want to go, but I just know that at this point, I can't really help anybody on the crew with this type of play. I am close to him. And I'm not gonna call a block charge on him because that's who's primary.
Please.
And we talked the other day about Lee being able to see what that the slot can't see on block charge plays?
Lateral movement.
Right? So I'm not gonna call this because to me it's gonna always look like a charge. When you see the baseline view, the guy's doing this, and it's like clear as day a block. It's just that's the way physics work or whatever. So I'm not gonna call anything on him because I know my man Fedora's got him. And I'm not gonna call anything on him because he's, I have a close look. I knew when this play was out here that I was already in trouble. You find out as he continues on and you're like, oh man, I need to do something. That's okay. It's all about experience. You got 5 years, I got like 20. Big difference. Big difference. You've done this exercise maybe 20 times, I've done it probably 20,000. And the more you do it, it gets easier. Much easier. And you'll be amazed at how the plays slow down. Because you're so far ahead of them. Because you've done the tape work. Everybody heard Donald yesterday when he's talking about the guy doing the step back, he's watched the tape, he knows his moves. That's what it is. You learn how things operate, you learn the way the system works all by doing this exercise. So this play started here, kind of out here. So who's gonna be responsible for this guy with the best look? This defender, who is the primary guy?
Trail,
because he has what?
An open look.
He has an open look at this defender, right? Her look back, she sees four or whatever his number is, not good. And it's not because you didn't move properly, it's just because that's the way the play developed. It's nothing to speak ill of your officiating, it's just that's the way it works. Every time down the floor, it's gonna be close to somebody. Who's got this guy? Lee. And we're in good spots to see that. All right, so here we go, let's just see how it plays out. Oh, runner. Good. We always want to look at how we look coming up the floor. Fedora's about two or three strides behind the ball. That's good. He's coming up. Slot wants to come up with the pace of the ball, preferably two or three strides ahead of it. You know, trying to pace your way up the floor. Lead wants to get, the rule of thumb is if you're the lead, you want to work every game to try to get to the baseline before the ball crosses midcourt. That is my goal in the lead. When I work, I want to be on the baseline before the ball crosses midcourt. If I'm watching my tape and I'm not getting to the baseline, to the balls at the free throw line extended in the front court, I am not giving enough hustle. If I'm not to the baseline, to the balls at the 20-foot mark in the front court, I have to give more hustle. Okay? We want to get to our spot and accept the plays as they come down the floor. All right? So we can't see how, at what point Michael got there, but I'm going to say Michael got there before the ball crossed half court. And that's where we want to be. Now, there are certain times where it can't be. Maybe there's trapping, maybe they're playing pressure D in the backcourt. Obviously, it's not always, always say always and never say never, but that is your rule of thumb. If we're just having normal, bringing the ball up, there's no reason why you shouldn't at the lead get there before the ball crosses your court. All right, so we have the ball here in the wing. Now I know that mechanics are a little different between college and men's college and women's college and high school and pro. So, you know, I'm gonna just speak mostly to the pro game. The line, so we talked about the line of the slot side lane line being the transition area between trail and slot, right? Do we know what the transition line is between lead and trail? What's that transition point on the floor?
Free
throw line extended. Were you telling me, Eric, where you were at? Were you kind of like, you're confident with that?
Fairly confident.
Yeah. Oh, okay. Right, free throw line extended. So when the ball enters this area, trail and lead have potential to be on at the same time. But when it clearly gets below, we need to have the lead on it, okay? That's just how I think it should work. That's the way we work it. I think when this college works, and men's are the ones that are a little bit behind. So, when the ball is in this area, in that transition area, who has to look at whose eyes to see who's on ball?
Trail.
There you go. Same as the opposite with the slide. It's always the trail's responsibility, right? Trail has to say, okay. Fedora has to say, what's Michael doing? Michael, would you say you're on ball or off ball? Based on this picture, it's not clear, I understand that, but based on your head position, what do you think you're on or off ball?
Off ball.
I think you're off ball as well. So if I'm Fedor, I would say to myself, Michael's not on ball. So guess what I'm going to do at the trail?
Pick up the ball.
I'm going to go on ball. You have to referee where your lead cannot, right? So if I look at Michael and then I say, oh, Michael's on ball, then guess what I'm going to do?
Off ball.
I'm going to go off ball, okay? That's the system. So we don't have two guys constantly on two players. And you find that at the younger levels, the lesser experienced levels, and that's okay. Because there's just something innately in us to say, I gotta watch the ball. Just like watching, like a fan watching the game. A fan watching the game never takes their eyes off the ball, ever. They don't know what goes on off ball. They have no idea. So when you get a hold off ball, they're like, man, how do you see that? Because he or she's not watching the ball 90% of the time, 100% of the time like you are. We have other responsibilities. So we have to train ourselves, we have to be disciplined, and we have to trust that if you're on ball, I have to go off it. If Michael is on ball, I trust that Michael can referee these two people. I just trust that. I have to trust that, otherwise the system can't work, right? And if I know you're on ball, then I do this. Now what Michael can't do in the lead is this. So ball's here and there's people on the post, he can't do this. Why can't he do that?
You watch two players, you miss maybe what's going on there.
No, not what I'm looking for. Why can't I go ball, off ball?
Because then the trail, you don't know what's picked up.
Boom!
Yeah.
I'm in the trail, I'm like, well, what do you want me to do? Tell me what you want me to do, because you're trying to do both. Right? So if you go with one, you stick with it. That's the decision you made, and there's no right or wrong. But that's the decision you made, so it was like, oh, he's decided to stay on ball, or off ball. I'm gonna go on ball. But you can't go back and forth, back and forth, back and forth. Now what you can do is you're in the post, right? And then you feel the ball get below free throw line. Then you go from ball, from post to ball, because you're like, oh, this is my responsibility, it's below free throw line. And that's the transition. So you go here, and then that guy or girl should go where you just left. Make sense? All right, good deal. So we have a three taken. Everybody wants to be Steph and Clay. We got this three taken. Let's talk about rebounding responsibilities, okay? Do we know what rebound are? Okay, so let's start with, we're gonna start with Fedor. You're in the trail, right?
Yep.
The trail is responsible for what type of rebound? What's it called? There is actually a name for it. Okay, all right, no problem. Trust me, it's okay, it's all right. And this is not trying to fool the referee type, you know, it's just if you know, you know, if you don't, you don't. That's why we're here. Trail is responsible for what's called perimeter rebounding. Perimeter rebounder, rebounding. Trail's responsibility is perimeter rebounding. And why we need to know these things is so that when we're out on the floor and we can do them, we're all watching our areas of responsibility. This is why we can only watch a couple of minutes and it takes forever, because we're really getting down to the nuts and bolts of officiating. So Fedor's area is perimeter rebounding. Perimeter rebounding is the area directly in front of the rim. So you got the tip of the, you know, the top, the RA, the restricted area. Just think about it right here, this of the restricted area. This area where people are boxing, if there were people boxing out right in front of the rim, that's Trail's responsibility, okay? He's responsible for whomever, whatever matchup is here trying to go up, okay? Lead, we know what lead is responsible for when it comes to rebounding. Lead is responsible for strong side rebounding. Strong side rebounding. And that is the area on the block right in front of the rim on his side of the floor. Block on his side of the rim. So we say these guys are strong side rebounders. Yes, they are. That would be the lead, in this case, Michael's responsibility. Slot, if the lead is responsible for strong side rebounding, what would slot be responsible for? Weak side rebounding, which is the complete opposite of his, right? So if it's his box or her box on her side of the rim. So we have these areas covered, right? These are the areas where people rebound. People don't box out up here to rebound, right? That's not the way basketball is played. rebounds come right off by the rim. So the three most centered areas, the three most concentrated areas of rebounding are all covered. Now we're gonna add a caveat to it. When you are responsible for the jump shot, which means we don't just, oh, there's a three, we just leave him, right? We take him all the way back down to the floor, make sure he's got a proper landing and things like that. When you are responsible for the jump shot, you're going to get to your rebounding coverage a little bit late. Makes sense? Because you're watching the guy go up, you're watching to make sure that he doesn't, the defender doesn't take his legs out. And then you're transitioning your eyes from that to your rebounding. And by the time you do that, the ball's like 3/4 of the way there. Should be. Should be, if you do it properly. Which means these guys have already started boxing out, right? So we got these guys already that are already working for positioning, and here's the ball, right? So imagine how much is going on by the time this ball is here. A lot has gone on between these two, right? So whoever's responsible for the shot's gonna see the end part of that. They're not really gonna see a whole lot of it. They're gonna see 2 out of the 5 frames. So they need help. And you have to know on the floor who was responsible for the shot, what their rebounding coverage is, and then you have to know that I have to help them. So because Michael decided not to go on ball, who was responsible for the shot?
The trail.
The trail. Fedora was responsible for taking this young man up and bringing this young man back down to the floor, which means he's going to need help in what type of rebounding?
Perimeter.
So Slot has to have an awareness like, okay, this is not my shot, but I know Fedora's on and I know he's responsible for perimeter rebound. I'm gonna have to go there and help out. I can't just go to weak side as well. I gotta kind of try to do both. And most of the time, here's a key. There's not one going on in both areas, right? So I'm gonna say, oh, I gotta help Fedora in perimeter rebounding. Oh, thank God, there's nothing going on in perimeter rebounding. Oh, my area. Oh, I have nothing going on in weak side rebounding. So I guess I'll be a good partner and I'll do whatever I can to assist my man, Michael, right? So I'll assist Michael with strong side rebounding because we have nothing going on here, we have nothing going on here. So that's the way the system works. So if Michael is on the shot, he takes the shooter up, he brings him down, he needs help where?
Strong side.
Strong side rebounding. Fedora has to stay engaged and be able to look here and here, and I guarantee you both spots won't be filled. All right, does all that make sense? Do we all have a better understanding of how referee rebounding coverage? Thank you very much, that'll be $100. Yeah. All right, here we go. Let's see what happens. That was the only matchup. We only had one in it, the ball just happened to serendipitously go over to them, right? So the backside guy actually gets it, which is rare, it was a long rebound. Okay, ball's at the top of the key, whose responsibility?
Trail.
So if we got Slot and we can't see, if you're pinking here, you'd be like, red X, if you're pinking there. You don't know. You gotta help somewhere, anywhere but the ball, because we got somebody on the ball. So nothing going on, this is your guy. That's it, there's two guys here, the other three. Nothing going on. Michael, you got the post, right? Right?
I did.
Yes, all right, good. I like the fact that you're at the close down. We call it now just lane line. You're at the lane line because the ball was, he's dribbling at the top of the key. Fine. He starts to make his way back on the strong side and kind of settle there. As he tries to make his way this way, you need to start backing out. Okay, we want the lead to, as often as possible to at least mirror the ball when it's on the strong side. When it's on your side of the floor, you should at least mirror it. So you shouldn't be at the close down or at the lane line and the ball's over here. That's refereeing inside out. We'd rather people referee outside in, meaning you're outside of the play and you have this kind of big picture review. Okay? So I see if you move. You do. Good. and you still should be in the post.
Mm-hmm.
What I would like to see is, I would like to see Fedor somewhere, right? You're kind of, so because you're not in the picture, you're probably back over here, I don't know. But what position adjusting is extremely important in officiating. It's all about angles. Like Darnell talked about it last night, right? He said, back in the old days, guys, referees would be back behind me, you know, shooting. And that's how we miss these types of things and the pokes that he said he used to do. If we're behind the play, we gotta move. If we see numbers, we gotta move. So I would love if I saw him and he was in this picture somewhere working to get an angle. Now, because I paused it, I don't know if that's going to happen when I hit play. So just something to think about. So if I made this move and I'm getting down and being able to see, because I don't know if the kid's going to shoot or not, I want to be prepared in case he does. And then he dishes it down into the post. I have no problems back around another couple of steps. A lot of times you see people position adjust, but they don't position adjust again. It's not just a one-time thing. You can position adjust 5 or 6 times on one possession. Easily. So you don't think you made one move and you're good for the rest of that possession. It has to be, the game is fluid. The players are constantly moving. Our angles are constantly changing as a result of their movements. So we have to constantly move to maintain and keep open angles. Okay? We don't want to be behind shooters. We don't want to be in stacks. So that's never a good feeling. Okay, so what kind of play is this called? So we got the ball, and it kind of, let's see, it's kind of hard to do rewind on this thing, so I'll try my best. Oh, good, okay. So now the ball's on the low block, right? Would we say Michael is refereeing outside in or inside out? It's open to anybody.
Outside.
Kind of outside.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I would like to see? And this is why I watch tape. So this is why it's hard for me to say when you guys ask me on the floor, hey, what do you think? It's hard for me because of, well, I'm sitting on a baseline. I don't have a great vantage point as far as how especially, you know, where you are. So, stand up for Michael. Come on up, young man. You're not that old. You haven't had jerk coffee. See, that's what it is. All right, so he's kind of like, this is the baseline. He's kind of standing like this, right? Is that about right? So this is the baseline.
Yeah.
This is how he's kind of standing, right? I'm just gonna make a slight adjustment to how he's standing. First of all, I would say take a step to your left. Get a little better.
Mm-hmm.
And instead of this, move this foot. There you go, like open it up, right?
Yeah.
So you're gonna see more of this versus, see how my angle changes based on this movement? Okay, that's what we want, more of a big picture, wider. So
yeah.
Get those shoulders like that. And that's where you should be on either side of the lead. If you're rotating over, it should be like, boom. Just the same as the trail, but on the baseline. Okay, big picture. So I'd like to see a little turn and a step wider, right? Now this player is doing what? So he dribbles and he's doing what? The dribbler is hurling into the lane. So he's going from like an, if he was out here, it would be an A look if he was a step or two out to his left. But because he's kind of like this way, flat-footed, looking down at that baseline more or so, even though he's looking at the play, but he's got this kind of view. But the moment this kid starts to do this turn, his look goes from A minus B to what? A grade. I mean grade.
D.
F. Failing. You were failing, just the same as Kate or Kat earlier, right? When she was in the slot. It's not because he's in a horrible position, does not referee. It's just because the kid decides to make a move this way. So we have to referee where our partners cannot. We have to work here very hard. Why?
This is coming towards you.
There you go. This is going to start coming your way. You got to do whatever you can to fight to see an open look. Now, where do you think you should go based on you got this cluster? Where do you think you should go? What's going to be the best option for you?
Go high.
You got to go up.
Yeah.
That's the only thing you can do. Okay? You go down, you just keep looking up people's butts. Not just not gonna happen for you. And you have to fill this live. You gotta fill this live, right? And know as instinctively, if I am here with, if I am Cat in the slot, and when the guy got the ball on the block, I'm already saying to myself, it's not my primary, but I'm saying to myself, my God, if he goes over his right shoulder, that's gonna be me. And God dang it, look at these people. I'm gonna do this. Oh, what do you know? He curled to his right. Went over his right shoulder. I'm already in position. I'm already refereeing the play before it happens. What we instinctively see, and it's just natural, is that until you get more experience, you're going to be more reactive rather than proactive. Right? That's why on the other end, you didn't move until after the guy made a couple dribbles. He's going to the lane, and you're like, oh, I need to move. Well, when you start to see these plays develop, so guess what? I go high, already there's, and the kid doesn't curl over his way. Let's say he goes this way, it doesn't fade away. So guess what I do? I'm like, oh, cool, that's not my responsibility. I'm just gonna take another step back to the free throw line and get ready for rebounding on the weak side. I took those steps for a purpose. Your movement should always serve a purpose. Always. He decided to do something else. So my purpose was no longer needed. So now I go back and I prepare myself for rebounding, okay? So he's curling to the lane, so Cat's gonna have to fight. Trail has to fight because this is his defender, right? This is the kid digging down because we know our lead's in trouble.
On that play, as the C, would you also recommend taking steps out of the court or just moving up?
No, go up because you got this kid. You move on to the floor.
Might get in your way.
So where should I be?
Maybe here.
Okay.
Maybe. And it all would depend on what this kid's. Because these people are doing what? What is it called in basketball?
Spotting up.
They're spotting up. Curl, boom, kick. Right? If I'm here, if I'm where my man is in the red shirt, I've got a potential open look. Here, on anything on a, here. And if he kicks it, I'm in okay position for 2-3 with these people. Right? All right, good question. So Michael should have been saying to himself what Cat should have been saying to himself earlier, this play is going away from me. This kid's running away from me. I gotta be very careful here. I gotta be very disciplined here. I have to trust my partners here. This play is going away from me and I'm going to have a closed look. I really can't do a whole lot on this play. Even though the play is 2 feet from me, right? We said earlier, proximity does not always mean, what's the answer? Primary. Proximity does not always mean primary. That is a great example. You were the closest to that play by far. It is not your primary. It was the young lady across the floor. Nobody in the world understands that. So if something happened, guess who they're gonna yell at? Boom! How'd you not see that?
It was right in front of you.
It's right there! You're freaking blind? They don't know officiating. They don't know officiating, right? Meanwhile, if I was you and something happened, I'd be like, damn it, what's Cat doing over there? Come on, let's pick it up. Let's fight. Okay, we gotta work. We gotta work. Okay? Okay, Fedor. Ball is clearly on slot side, right?
Yeah.
Clearly. So what would we like to see you do in the lead?
What can I do?
What can you do potentially?
Okay. For me, I'm about to close down.
There you go. Close down. Close down and just get yourself in position to potentially rotate if the ball does what?
Settles.
Yeah. The ball settles, we go. In this case, they're kicking it back around the horn. Alright? But just that close down is the difference between a lead being on time and a lead being late. When a lead is late, it puts undue pressure on the slot. And when you have undue pressure on you in officiating, you get antsy. And the lesser experience you have, the more antsy you get. Oh my God, there's like five people over here. Come on, Fedor. And we have a tendency to jump on plays because it's getting antsy. When the lead is on time, it's like, ooh, good, I just got the ball on their defender, right? He's got that other stuff now. We have a tendency to be more relaxed, more calm, and we're really good when we're relaxed and calm. And so that's why the lead is so crucial, back and forth, making sure we rotate on time, all the time, all right? All right, well, that's some of the stuff about positioning, looking at our bodies. Let's take a look at this real quick. Good, Michael. Now let's see the recording. This is the first whistle we've heard. Mm-hmm. And then I'm going to rewind it and let you all look at it again. And then I want grades. We grade each other in my class, not the teacher. What happens on this play? Rewound it, just trying to see how we do with that recall.
Is this the curl in play?
Curl, right? We just saw this. It's all about recall. I remember when I first started refereeing, and I moved to Atlanta to referee. I wanted to be a referee. So I moved to Atlanta. I was like, screw law school. I can go back to that later. I want to be a referee. I'm going to move 600 miles from home. That's what I did. And when I get down, I think I know way more than I know. So I'm refereeing with all these guys that are like SEC guys, some guys that are trying to get an NBA. I just have done intramurals, not even a high school game. And one of the games I'm doing in the summer, the guy's like, do you remember the play at that time? I was like, huh? No. Well, what about the play at 7? I'm like, man, I have no idea. And he's like, I can't help you. His exact words were, I can't help you if you don't have recall. And I was like, oh, well, first of all, what's recall? And he tells me what recall is. I'm like, oh, okay. I'm like, well, how do you do that? It's like, you just gotta know. You just gotta remember. And it's so hard when you start. It took me forever to get that. It's just, you got a million thoughts going through your mind. You can't remember. And it's amazing, the more you do it, it's like, oh gosh, I can remember a recall from a play I had in October in San Antonio. Again, when you do the exercise so much, the brain is so powerful. You know how powerful your brain is? It's extremely powerful. The most powerful computer in the world can't even compete with your brain. That's how sophisticated your brain is. Can't even come close to competing with it. So when you can get recall, you're going to get really, really good. Because not only do you remember plays, but you say, oh yeah, I remember that play 4-13, we're at 3-11, Fedora, no call that. I'm gonna no call that too. We're gonna be consistent.
How do you train your brain?
Repetition. Repetition.
Are there
repetition. So when I have something, as I was starting, it's like it was always just the big plays where we got big reactions. I'm like, okay, I'll look at the clock.
Ah.
9/11.
Okay, see, 9/11. That's what I did with little tips.
9/11. Like, so when you have something big where you get like, ooh, or that feeling like, maybe I should have a whistle there. You look at the clock. 4:13, okay, 4:13 of the second. I'm gonna have to come back to that. 4:13 of the second, and then you've refereed for another 30 minutes. You're like, yeah, what time was that play again? You're not gonna get it initially, but the more you do it, you'll say, oh yeah, okay, let's go look at 4:13. Let's take a look at what happened there. I did not have a great look. That's how you develop your recall. It's looking at the clock when something happens and knowing to keep that time in your head while you referee for the next 20, 30 minutes. Before you get to the locker room, we can check it out. Okay? So this is the curl play. Well, we're gonna go back and take a look at the blocking foul he had, which is the correct call. Obvious foul. We want obvious plays in our primary, so we're gonna do the exercise of what we should look at when we're breaking down tape and hit the pause. So remember the play, okay, everybody's got it? All right, cool, let's go. Okay, first part, is it his primary?
Yes.
Yes, check mark for Michael. Does he have an open look?
Yes.
Yes, check mark for Michael. Does he have a primary cadence on the play?
Yeah.
Yes, primary or his check mark for Michael. So he's 3 for 300%. And is the play called correctly? Yes. Do you know why? Because we did those three things right. When we do those three things correctly, we're really good. Our play call and accuracy goes like this. Right? When we call plays out of our primary, our play call and accuracy goes down. When we have closed looks, it goes down. When we're calling plays late, we're usually going down. It's not even if you're calling something in your secondary with the primary whistle too quick on it. It's probably because you should have waited another half second. Because the person who's refereeing the play, who is primary, is waiting a second or they're processing, right? So we're too quick, we're usually wrong. But when we get checks on those and we're honest, we're usually right. That's what we want. That's discipline. Okay. Now what about the reporting? What did he say? It was strong? Was it crisp? Did he project his voice? Did he report what happened? These are the types. What would we say?
Yes.
I agree. Okay, undercuts, what's blocked? Why 11? Right, I heard that on the tape, right? The volume was up, I heard him tell me it was wide 11 block, and I heard him tell me we were shooting two. It's all good. It's all. Now, if he had said wide 11 hits, like where'd he hit him? He hit the kid. Up ends a little bit, right? So, all that's good, Michael. All right, fast forward. Stuff here.
Oh, can we see this one for a second? Is possible?
Was this where you changed the call?
Yeah.
This is shooting, not shooting, right?
Yeah.
Recall, right?
Recall.
Right. All right, so let's go back to this. We had a couple of these elongated conversations. We're going to talk about these conversations. Now, this was the first one, right? We had two of them, correct?
Yep.
Well, we're going to talk about how to handle this.